seated.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Molweni. In terms of the powers vested in me as Vice Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare, I hereby declare this inaugural lecture to be presented by Professor Willie Chinyamrindi from the Faculty of Management and Commerce open. Thank you very much, Dean.
Vice Chancellor and Deputy Vice Chancellors, friends and academics. Today it's my honor to introduce to you the 33rd professor to be inaugurated at the University of Fort Hare, Professor Willie Chinyamrindi. It's very difficult to do a summary of the person that we need to introduce in the name of Professor Willie, but I'll try my best. Professor Chinyamrindi is an NRF-rated professor, Y2, and he is based within the Department of Business Management. Professor Chinyamrindi is a Pan-Africanist and a scholar with intent in promoting such ideals in his work. In 2021, he served as a co-chair of the South African Young Academy of Science, in addition to his professional membership with this society. This year, he was nominated to serve on a special committee crafting a national entrepreneurship strategy for South Africa, in which he chairs as the Education and Training Reference Group. As a broad theme, his research is along aspects of human and organizational capabilities and how they contribute towards the theme of development. This entails aspects such as human resources development and organizational psychology, covering sub-themes such as careers, employability, decent work, technology in human resources development, interpretivist research methods within the management sciences, entrepreneurship and strategic management, especially the intersection of strategy in organizational behavior. Further, Professor Chinyamrindi is also interested in research that improves his teaching practice. The nexus between humans and organizational capabilities becomes important, especially considering the role of technology and even socio-economic systems. In essence, the thread is around making the human experience better through harnessing and improving individual, organizational, and community capabilities. This has seen Professor Chinyamrindi's work published in local and international peer-reviewed journals. This is also includes being featured in a number of local and African newspapers. Professor Chinyamrindi is a recipient of numerous research funds from organizations such as the National Research Fund, South African Medical Research Council, Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR, National Institute for Human and Social Sciences, South African Cultural Observatory, National Heritage Council, and the Council for the Development of Social Science in Africa. Professor Chinyamrindi holds professional memberships with the South African Board of People Practices, Health Professions Council of South Africa, Psychological Society of South Africa, South African Career Development Association, and the South African Institute for Management Sciences. Thank you. Professor Chinyamrindi.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to stand before you and not part of the script though, but okay, let's do this. It gives me great pleasure to stand before you to present this inaugural lecture. I'm incredibly honored and delighted to give this lecture at this prestigious university. This all happening at a time which we have called the decade of renewal. I want to start by paying homage to this great institution and what it has made of me. Wearing the 40-year badge has been an honor for me, especially given the rich history that this university carries. In the West African country of Ghana, taken from the Twi language, is an Akan proverb that's really summated as, "It is not taboo to go back for what you forgot." From this, I have latched on to many experiences from the University of Fort Hare. And I want to take you back before I actually give the lecture to some of the moments that have shaped my career and leading to where I am today. Hence, I get a bit emotional about it because in reflecting about these moments, it has become very, very important for me to see where I've come from as a scholar, and obviously to try and position where I'm going. So I borrow from colleagues who have shared with me the story of the Sankofa bird, which you see right there. And the argument with the Sankofa bird is really a bird which, instead of looking forward, it's looking backward. And that's what I want to do this afternoon before we start the lecture, to try and look back at how it has all started. I position myself as a scholar who is within the applied management and work psychology fields. My career started off in 2002 at the University of Port Elizabeth, where I enrolled for a degree in human resources management. I subsequently would go and complete an honors and a master's degree at the Nelson Mandela University, and then would have work experience and studied more degrees, I guess, in countries like Ireland and the UK. Which I believe when I reflect back, it really has woven me to be where I am today. But some of you would ask the question, how did it all start to develop an interest in this field? My first experience in human resources was probably from my mother. She worked for 25 years within the Zimbabwean public service. And at that time, the term that was being used was personnel manager. So every time when I would go and see her at her office, it became very apparent to see the activities that she was involved in. These are activities summarized as the advisory role, where within this single office, it was a hive of activity with people coming from all over to seek advice. And here I was, just a schoolboy with a bag on my back, waiting for her to knock off and surely learning and seeing how she was dealing with all of this. I also would notice that her job was very administrative and intense. This entailed, obviously, at the end of the day, carrying all the huge amounts of files to the car and constantly asking what these files were. Unbeknown to me, some of them were disciplinary files where people were actually losing their jobs, but I faithfully carried those files to the car. The focus also, which was fascinating to me, was what I called the focus activity role. This was the function of reducing HR to certain key functions: recruitment, selection, training, and development. I then would then develop my next interest when I attended the prestigious Churchill Boys High School in Zimbabwe. At Churchill Boys High School at the A-level stage, I decided to do a computer project. And in this computer project, my interest was trying to fuse what some would call the human-computer interaction, to try and understand how do we make people work better with systems, or how do we make systems work better with people. I can clearly see now upon reflection that the interest in this human and organizational capability link started from such a young age. From doing all of this, I then proposed to the Zimbabwe Prison Service at that time that I was able to create a system that would help their prison staff in not only locking in or registering prisoners who have been admitted to the prison, but to also allow for some form of an interaction which improves how basically the prison system was going to be done. And so at that time, we were using what some would call SQL, structured query language. I then created this computer program. Unbeknown to me, what was at work here was the development of what I would then call research skills, particularly in qualitative research methodology. Unbeknown to me, I would also stand in front of people to sell the idea of this particular system. And I think the correct term they use nowadays is science engagement. And then my life took a turn. I went to the University of Port Elizabeth, where I would meet this woman by the name of Ms. Fairuz Abrahams, a registered industrial psychologist. She then developed a keen interest in assisting students at that particular time. One of the areas that she was interested in teaching us in was the area of work psychology and organizational behavior. A lot was happening in Port Elizabeth at that particular time. VW had entrenched itself as a dominant player in the motor manufacturing space. And it also included companies like Continental, who were doing quite well in that particular space. The mantra of the institution at that time, led by Professor Rolf Stompf, was ambassadors of an engaged institution. So on my first day where I was reporting to the honors class, I was actually late. And I was the only one who arrived late. And upon arriving late in a class with 15 to 20 other students, I couldn't find a place to sit. And Mrs. Abrahams then would say to me, "Welcome, take a seat." I would then later reflect on this statement, "Welcome, take a seat," in a book published by Professor Jonathan Janssen about South African great teachers, where I wrote a reflective account in appreciating how this statement allowed me and impressed upon me that I was going to become an academic. You see, the statement, "Welcome, take a seat," represented the answer that was to a question that I had been asking so long. How do I navigate through life in actually making a decision around what I want to do for the rest of my life? For me, the statement, "Welcome, take a seat," represented the responsibility and duty of care that we as academics can have in creating the next Professor Welichinya Morindi, who is standing before you presenting the 33rd Professor Inaugural Lecture. And that being said, I live by that mantra to this day, to my students, to my fellow colleagues, that indeed, welcome, take a seat. So I thought I would share with you that picture there. And VC, this really represents a decade of renewal for me, because when I look at the transformation, let's get into the lecture. At the core of what I do is an interest in the field of work psychology, particularly the future of work. The future of work has been branded as a future that is before us, and that is inevitable, that all of us must embrace and be part of. It really is a future that we must follow through in terms of what we want to achieve. The World Economic Forum has called this ideals of the future of work as the next important frontier that we should be focusing in developing the nations of the world. This is the time that countries should be embracing these ideals of the future of work. However, the concern I have is narrowly the future of work has been influenced by the framing of the role of what they call the fourth industrial revolution. I've got colleagues at the University of Johannesburg who have dedicated work in this area, looking at the role of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and digitalization. In my lecture this afternoon, I want to argue that the future of work, though embracing the importance of technology, is really a future that also should not leave behind the people and the human aspect of it. We then get in a debate with colleagues as to should we be using words like human capital management? And the issue of contention is how these words relegate people to just objects as part of an economic system, when these same people who are capital have got children at home who sometimes they cannot come to work because of challenges that are happening. And sometimes these human capital have got issues that even are affecting them, and we're talking a lot about mental health, which we'll reflect a lot later in the lecture. So the future of work has huge implications in understanding what business is all about. For the business sector, the argument is made that we need to integrate, collaborate, and embrace change. It is inevitable. It is part of us. But put differently, the argument I'm trying to make within my research is for a nuanced response towards this imagined future. There is need for us to therefore channel especially human capabilities in developing strategies that assist human beings and people to work better within such a future. Despite all this, the uncertainty is lingering on. In work that we've done, we've noticed that there's a lot of focus in advocating for the importance of enterprise development. It's rich sometimes to talk about everybody becoming an entrepreneur when some of the people don't even have food to be able to sustain themselves or to see the next meal. So a nuanced contextual consideration is needed. I illustrate with the work of my colleagues, my colleague Professor Simatele and Professor Kapingura, in their work on informality and rurality. We're talking about challenges that we are facing in growing the economy. Yet, the informal sector and rural contexts are growing, and yet there's this psychological distancing away from such contexts. I've often asked my students whether they would consider a career within the informal sector, and usually the answer given there is no. Everybody wants to go to Johannesburg, to Cape Town, end up driving a VW Polo, staying in Serbab, and eventually working their way through the top. So if local is indeed lacquer, what about the challenge that we have in trying to focus internationally? And this has been a criticism that has been posed towards the South African government, towards trying to find new friends who are appealing to our policies and our political direction that we're taking. I think, therefore, there is need to unpack what these human and organizational capabilities are, but what we need to move to what I have called here the imagined utopia. So the context of these capabilities calls us to forget the aliens, because we as human beings are not alone. We need dynamic capabilities in place that remind us of the competencies that are in organizations through the routines, processes, and the resources, and how these potentially transform us to be better. In essence, these capabilities are what makes one organization perform better than the other. At the core of these capabilities is therefore the necessity to develop people so that in the alliances that we form, the new products that come to the market, and the strategic decision-making that is happening, we have all of this encapsulated as part of our people mandate that we have. The capitalist system has not helped in this regard, because often people are often relegated as just a part of the process in achieving the aims that we need, and the aims purely capital in nature. So the clarion call from human relations, for the human relations perspective, is then to be reminded that great successful organizations are those that are able to make the balance between these human and organizational capabilities. So there's then this contentious issue about the capabilities in Africa. Professor Marwala calls it the great divide, the growing inequality that exists, the threat that this has towards human and organizational capabilities. I'm reminded of this every time when we do research and we conduct research in communities, that we are indeed living in a society which has a great divide. And in such a context, what then should we be doing in embracing the technologies of the future? And the answer for me is local responsiveness, regional competitiveness, and not forgetting the necessity to still remain internationally focused. In work that we have conducted, we note the challenges and threats towards the formation of these capabilities to be the high unemployment rate, the strike culture in the country, for instance, challenges in the public service, the challenges even to grow small businesses. And often we are starting to talk about the gig economy and moving away from just encouraging everybody to become an entrepreneur. And the issue of rurality and informality should not be neglected as part of necessary conversation in human and capability development. But we also note a challenge of governance, or should we call it a government with challenge. And that is an important intersection that we need to reflect upon as we head towards the national elections next year. So the opportunity for me as a researcher has then been magnified by all these challenges. I've dedicated my work to conducting the following. For instance, labor advocacy and the call that we need to make work work. Consider our friends in the TVET sector. Clearly, there are skills that are needed and ways of learning that we in higher education institutions like ours would need to embrace to be successful. I marvel at this because when I stayed in the UK, most of the people who were never out of work or always had work were the plumbers, the boiler makers, the artisans, the electricians, and academics. Well, there was a long pile of us who were constantly sending CVs all around to try and get that next job. When we reflect upon the informal sector and research that we are conducting, we are noting that the informal sector becomes an important priority, and I would like to commend the Investor Forte for seeing it fit in actually dedicating an RNA that is focused to the township economy in which most of these informal businesses are based. And the challenge that we need to do, the work that we need to do, is to find ways of growing such businesses. We also have lessons that we are drawing from employment studies. And notably, looking at how the role of disadvantage affects the uptake of skills and graduates, especially in our context. I want to share with you then some stories that I've learned on my journey in the research that we've conducted. A couple of years ago, a young man knocked on our gate asking if they could do the gardening at our house. And I was really reluctant because you don't know this person, and they insisted that they'll do the first work for us for free. And then if we are happy, we then take it from there. This young man is Mandilake Matuane, called Mario. And after 3 years of being with Mario, I then sat with him and sought to try and understand that Mario, in this economy that we are talking about in the present reality, how is a young entrepreneur like you surviving? And it goes back to the same issues around the challenges of capabilities. I mean, Mario flags the necessity for social and economic reform in how we can assist issues of human capability development. Mario operates and stays right here in Nompumelelo townships, just next to Beacon Bay. Mario also argues for the necessity of bold leadership. And I go back to the point I made. Do we have a governance challenge, or do we have a challenge with the government? Bold leadership that transforms and improves existing opportunities for the purpose of human and capability development. I learned this the hard way when one of our students, who we had assisted greatly to get into an internship in a government department, would come complaining that most of the time they are being asked to go and buy fat cooks down the road and not doing any work where there's transfer of skills. And I go back to the point, do we have a challenge with government, or a challenge with governance? There's also a necessity to reform bottlenecks that are existing in the system, and these are widely researched by even colleagues in my department who have found challenges of a system and structural nature and how they impede not only service delivery, but issues and challenges related to human and capability development. And so I put pen to paper and decided to write an opinion piece around the State of the Nation address with advice to the president around how young youth entrepreneurs can be assisted in navigating through some of these challenges, which some of them are mostly man-made. I also reflect on some work that we've done, particularly in the informal sector. And this is an important sector because we published a paper in the African Journal of Business, Economic Management Sciences under a special issue which was trying to document the experiences of the informal sector. What we've noticed within this sector, particularly in the Eastern Cape province, we are experiencing a 1.8% contraction in terms of the gross domestic product. In other words, this means bad news for us, and it's even worse on the horizon, and how this is going to impede and affect issues related to human and capability development. There's also the necessity to create a future of work, yet realizing that two-thirds of provincial government expenditure is being spent on salaries alone. Says a lot about service delivery. It says a lot about growing the economy to embrace this future that we're interested in. So what do we need to do to grow the economy, accounting for the informal sector? And this is the question that I've been asking in that, how do we move from reality to this utopia? And I want to propose to you six strategies informed by the research that we've done in how we can do that. The first point is we need to be aware of paradox around us. There's a long-held view that human and organizational capabilities operate and exist within a context of paradox. Paradox here can be summarized as being voices of three agents that are at play. The optimists around us who appreciate the transformative role that technology and new forms of work can assist us in getting to this utopia that I'm talking about. We also have pessimists who take a more concerned view around the future of work. In research we do, we meet them all the time, those who are not trusting of employees working from home. In one transcript that I want to share of what one manager simply said to us is that we just don't know what is happening behind the screens. Are they really working? And so we must adopt a hard stance view. We also have pragmatists' argument here of the work of Mutlanga, who argues that we need to use the current challenge that we are experiencing as a way of propelling us to this utopia. The need here is really for employees and organizations that navigate through this uncertainty created by paradox over the last couple of years in trying to find ways in which we can affirm the belief that people matter the most in organizations. In fact, it is people who drive these capabilities that make successful organizations. Paradox also features in looking at the statistics that are released by Statistics South Africa. Take for instance, our total employment has increased by 104,000 or 1% year on year between June 2022 and June 2023. Now this is marginal. In fact, some would really call it a drop in the ocean. But look at what is going on with full-time employment. On the decrease, 46,000 or a negative 0.5% year on between June, the same reporting period. What we are noticing that is increasing is part-time employment. In Europe, they are starting to talk about the gig economy. And this has increased by 150,000 or 13.2% year on year between the same reporting period. What does this all mean? We need research that addresses the real life issues that are affecting people on the ground. And this is an angle that I've taken with students and colleagues that I work with, that paradox is around us. We're starting to engage ourselves in public work around the issue of decent work. And we could even ask a question, what does decent work mean for that person who is working 12 to 13 hours a day to get a salary which is not even equivalent to last them even a week of their expenditure? We need to start talking about developing people and the capabilities that exist, particularly using technology as a force to reckon with. And this is then this nuanced position that I'm going to present a little bit earlier on, later on. Research that is needed and that we are trying to do in this area is also trying to understand what does resilience look like for employees and people who are faced by these challenges. We're starting to note challenges of a mental health nature that is happening and affecting and as a threat towards human and capability development. A PhD student, the story was just shared recently, Zikhona Dlaza, recently won a best paper at the South African Public Management Association conference, in which she was looking at how organizations are embracing, how individuals are embracing mindfulness techniques in addressing or answering to this call for resilient organizations. Unfortunately, within an organizational setting in some companies, there appears to be no response towards these issues of resilience, particularly in assisting people in during challenging times such as our own. So our research is calling for new forms of work, but new forms of work that do not negate at the core people and the issue of capability development. And this is work that we've published with my colleagues from the Gordon Institute of Business Science. The second point that I'm arguing for is for us to be mindful of our own black swan events. The literature is starting to talk a lot about these black swan events. Notably, one such black swan event was the COVID-19 pandemic, which has been widely researched. I remember the time when we were emerging from the pandemic, every other honors student who wanted to work with me would always come up with a study around the impact of COVID-19, the impact of COVID-19. And this really attests also to the interest that the topic has generated. But what we are talking about particularly is for a nuanced understanding of these black swan events. And the black swan events are those disruptions that are affecting us. In South Africa, the featuring of technology within the context of work becomes important as a disruptor. But also, other black swan events that are affecting our capability development on a human and organizational side is load shedding. And I'm praying at any moment now we don't experience load shedding. The growing inequality that is happening. And one of the reasons why I have chosen deliberately to stay at an institution like the University of Fort Hare is to be part of this story that we are trying to build of students, some of whom are the first students to use a computer in their entire family. I kid you not, I have met some of these students who are sacrificing some of their funding that they have to take care of people at home. And an occasion like the one we'll be having tomorrow at graduation becomes an important event where I also get to meet the other side of those people who have benefited from the students just being here and working on some of the projects that we are doing. The current economic uncertainty. This economic uncertainty is really one of the greatest threats that is affecting human and capability development, particularly in the South African context. And the focus of our ongoing research is making a clarion call that there needs to be economic redress as a way of trying to also try and bring in new partners and new players to this particular economy. And there's no better place that I've dedicated 11 years of my life and 15 years back in the country in committing towards a brand such as the University of Fort Hare and what it is doing, especially to our black students, some of whom are the first to even come to university. The Black Swan events has also led us to try and develop a body of work that informs my the theory practitioner and policy press around organizational and capability development. A few a month ago, I received a call from the Department of Small Business Development to say we would like you to chair the cluster that is responsible for crafting the National Entrepreneurship Strategy with an emphasis on the education and training cluster. This has led us to try and mobilize all our friends in the TVET sector, a lot of whom are watching this lecture, to try and say, how then can we be part of this important work of having our voices be heard? And this is all coming to an academic who is based at the University of Fort Hare. And sometimes this is something I try to encourage even with our colleagues, that we have world-class academics in this institution whose work is now being noticed by colleagues outside and who people want to be part of this particular work that they are doing. And this is something I'm not ashamed of actually affirming and working in expressing and being proud of, to be affiliated with this great institution. The third nexus that we need to be careful of is positioning the future of work in addressing what they've called local and grand challenges. And the challenge here for me is really trying to understand that in as much as we need to be competitive in reaching world-class standards and the work that we are doing, we must also be conscious of the world with its material challenges that is around us. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals are seen as crucial in setting this agenda. And I've positioned myself particularly with an interest in Sustainable Development Goal number 8, which is around decent work and economic growth. And I think within the future of work, we also need to be harping and talking about the importance of decent work. I am reminded of ancient Greek mythology that registers the story of a young man by the name of Icarius, who was warned by Daedalus not to fly too close to the sun, else the beeswax that were holding his wings would melt. Unfortunately, Icarius did not heed to this warning and flew too close to the sun, and he would meet his demise plunging into the sea and subsequently drowning. And that's how I sometimes feel we are operating. We like to talk the lofty ideals of what the future of work is about, but we fail to link this future of work to issues, the material issues that are affecting people around us. Let me illustrate. For instance, there's the push for the introduction of robotics as part of meeting manufacturing and production goals. Yet there's also a resistance at what it means to this already precarious labor situation that we have. The second pointer, amidst the great reset phenomena, there's a need that we need to balance between how employees not only engage with work, but the role that technology can assist them in the engagement of that particular future of work. And we haven't even started to talk about what type of technologies do we need to embrace, factoring also the material conditions that are affecting the people. We illustrate this in some work that we are doing, particularly in Butterworth with the informal sector there, and acknowledging also that a discussion around the future of work needs to also include such sectors as this informal sector. The future of work is not just in Sandton, Cape Town, Durban, in lofty offices. The future of work is really in the townships around us, in the rural areas around us, in all the marginalized and often neglected areas that we often do not look into. The fourth nexus we need to imagine, to challenge, particularly within the future of work, is challenging what has been called weirdness within the literature. Weirdness here refers to the lack of case example, nuanced responses to how people are affected by the challenges around work, and also considering the dominance that is existing, particularly with a lot of Western educated focused samples in industrialized, rich, democratic nations. This is a phenomenon which has been framed by others as being part of what they've called the global north. The dominance really here has therefore then suffocated theories and theorists, particularly those from the African context, while at the same time, it has created other people's voices to be somewhat a little bit more superior. And so what happens is really the challenge of then people trying to understand. I sit with journal editors who receive work around the work we're doing in the informal sector and who are very much impressed and want to understand and do not understand what is the concept of a township. One of my colleagues would then challenge the journal editor at one time to say, you know Soweto? Yeah, just imagine a big Soweto in each and every African country as being part of what this township is. Professor Simatele is laughing. So, what has this meant for me? I'm happy to report that in a recently published work that we've done, which is gaining a lot of traction, I argue for the necessity to embrace Afrocentric stories, case examples, and agents within the management sciences. The South African Journal of Education has published this work where I say that we need to hear more stories of businesses from the African context that are surviving in the midst of all the turbulence and how these feature predominantly. I think we need to also embrace the ideals of a decolonized curriculum by also embracing these stories agents. I call this, we need our own superheroes and their stories, not just in the classroom, but using these stories from the communities and the businesses that we operate with and showing how they are reacting and responding to challenge. I also share the importance here of reading outside of your discipline. This is something that I've enjoyed as a narrative inquirer around seeking to understand what other disciplines can teach us. For instance, I recently learned the story of Soga, Tio Soga, around how Soga was married to a Scottish woman and how he tried to try and strike a balance in trying embracing the world views of the Scots and also his African origins, which are predominantly rooted here in the Eastern Cape. I then ask myself, do the methods that I use as a researcher empower people or do they take power from people? We are working on a collaborative work with colleagues from the Nelson Mandela University around the use of techniques such as self-study and bringing them into the classroom. And again, these are things I've learned even reading the biographical analysis of people like Soga. And what do I also take from the works of Soga? The necessity to strike a balance in worldviews. Despite him being trained in Scotland, he really remained grounded in his African intellectual thought processes. In my view, Soga was one of the first to teach us of how we can manage global North and global South interactions, including the power hegemonies that are at play in the present. The second point, especially from a management discipline, Soga still remained buoyant in trying to get local knowledge experiences shared to the global audience. We get requests from editors who would like us to write and chronicle experiences of township enterprises and how they are responding as part of the next frontier of business that we need to be conscious of. Soga was also pioneering in that he made the effort to even translate John Bunyan's classic book, Pilgrim's Progress, to fit within the experience of the Xhosa people. This is all exciting for me because I then ask myself, such a lofty bar has been set by somebody who is here from the Eastern Cape, linked also to the communities that are around us. And this is encouragement that we especially need to challenge weirdness, particularly within the management sciences. The fifth nexus is we need to embrace the positive of the future of work. We need to be cautious that we do not throw the baby out with the bathwater. And the idiomatic expression, throwing the baby out with the bathwater, is the caution that we need to embrace. We need to also be part of a future of work that enhances human and organizational capability development through homegrown local technologies that are affecting how we operate. I share the case example here of the M-Pesa story, which has become a global phenomenon. People in Russia are using M-Pesa, which has its origins within the East African community. I share the experience here of Ubuntu software system, which is also receiving its popularity across the world. So the caution really here is that not everything about the future of work, particularly the technology dimension, is bad. We need to also be cautious that we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. And this is something we are seeing also in the research that we are doing, the necessity to balance between the interfaces that we are operating within. Finally, we also need to be cautious that at a time such as this, we need effective leadership, But we also need people that lead for effect within the ideals of the future of work. I borrow these words from Professor Maurice Mtombeni from the Gordon Institute of Business Science, who is making this clarion call to academics, especially within the management sciences, to be part of this process of effective leadership or leading for effect. And the balance really here is needed. It is a type of balance that requires leaders and managers that also understand at the core of meeting objectives, targets, are people. We need to balance between this appeal for a level of humanity, particularly in the organizations that people work within. Effectiveness here becomes crucial and does not all of a sudden relegate us not to desiring a quest for meeting targets, but it's really meeting targets in a humane manner. Celebrated author Peter Drucker once said, "The questions leaders and managers answer are timeless, but the answers themselves change." So what does this all mean, colleagues, in my parting words? And I put that all in yellow because those are experiences that we have learned in the research that we've done. The need to continuously evaluate and monitor. The need to create a safe passageway through which people and their development can be allowed to happen. And the need to promote policies that are people-friendly while also at the same time enhancing the meaning and the experience of work. The need to train and offer skills support, especially at a time when we need these skills, what have been branded as the skills for the future. Finally, there is a need to make linkages between performance management systems and decision making frameworks that are friendly to the development of people and the organizations that they work in. The future of work is here and is within us. I offer gratitude this afternoon to quite a lot of people who have helped in shaping me to be where I am today. I thank my family, which I call the Chi Squad, who are well represented here. And some we had to struggle to give them bow ties to wear, but we're working on that. I thank my family around the diaspora who are watching in the United States, the United Kingdom, in Zimbabwe, Zambia, in Uganda, all over, for their continued support in helping me and instilling the values of hard work from a young age. I thank all the postgraduate students that have come with me in the current stages that we are celebrating, three of them tomorrow, and those that have now left the institution who are now doing well in their own right in the different institutions in higher education and in industry. I acknowledge also collaborators, local and international. Professor Shambare mentioned quite a lot of them, who have been always providing a home and a space for me which I can be part of this important journey. I boast in saying the following, that all the students I work with are mostly, 90% of them are funded. And this type of resourcefulness has allowed me to knock on doors and tell and sell great ideas to funders about the work that we are doing here at Forte, and without reluctance, they fund us. The funding agencies who have funded my research to date, the University of Forte management and the colleagues, and also the communities and the individuals who give up their time to share with us their experiences so that we can write about them and hopefully influence change. You are all important to the work that we are all celebrating today. Thank you.
Let's give Professor Chinyamurinde a much bigger round of applause. Much bigger. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, in terms of the powers vested in me as Vice Chancellor of the University of Fort Hare, I hereby congratulate and welcome Professor Willie Chinyamurinde to the ranks of inaugurated professors of the university. I wish him a very productive research and academic career.
Thank you.
Just as I hand over this certificate to Professor Chinyamurindi, I just need to make this note. The apex of an academic, the end point is to become a full professor. This is a ritual, it's a tradition that we treasure in the academy. And Professor Chinyamurindi joins the ranks of full professors. Every young person, every academic who grows up, the end point, the end goal is to reach this point. Once again, congratulations, Professor Chinyamurindi.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Molweni. My name is Ntabiseng Taulem Jimba. I am the Deputy Vice Chancellor responsible for research as well as partnerships and innovation. And I'm here to offer this message of support to you, Professor Chinyamurindi, on this special day. We have been waiting for it. We saw it in the social media, and I could see that you are really, really excited about it. It's really a very special day, and we are all very happy that you have reached this great milestone. Let me greet everyone here, the VC, members of MEC, deans, deputy deans, heads of departments, colleagues, students, and you, the family of Professor Chinyamurindi. Indeed, it's always it's a special moment when we have to do this inaugural professorial lectures, and it's one of those occasions where one really feels like, you know, they are in a university, a proper university. And today, as I was thinking about this special one, I asked myself, why are we doing this? And really, every time we do it, it becomes very clear as to why this inaugural lectures. The first point that those lectures provide is a platform to share what professors have done over the years, to share their teaching and learning achievements, their research and innovation achievements, as well as engagement achievements. And we have seen today, through what Professor Chinyamurindi has presented, that deep thought around what confronts us around the future of work. We also, through these lectures, want to celebrate and recognize, acknowledge the work that has been done by professors. And again, today is one of those days where we are celebrating you, Professor Chinyamurindi, on the work that we are doing. Following the promotion, of course, one could have, you know, the tradition has been, of course, that you know, you are acknowledged in one way or the other. But in addition to that, we have to do this as a very important ritual to ensure that we celebrate you, we acknowledge you, and we really offer our commitment to the support that we need to give as an institution to the academics, to researchers of your caliber. And most importantly, which you did very well at the beginning of your lecture, is to provide that Sankofa bird moment where you reflect and you tell us what it is that you are intending to do as part of your career. And I think to also share with us where you come from so that we can get to appreciate where you are now. So again, as part of my message of support to you, which is really part of congratulating you and kind of rejoicing with you for this great milestone, that commitment is both from yourself and ourselves as the university. And from yourself, of course, I saw that you are now, you are a Y2 rated researcher, and that is coming to an end at the end of this year. And then I went back to the days when I was working for the National Research Foundation, and also looking at academics who started off as Y-rated researchers. Most of them, and really most of them, if you track how they have progressed, you'll see that they become very powerful and they become really established in their career. And you will find that, as we used to describe it then, a Y2 rated researcher is somebody who is young, under 40 years or younger, and who has held a doctorate for maybe 5 years, and of course who show and is being recognized as somebody who has a lot of potential. So indeed, that is the space where you started. But looking at your profile now, I see a very firm professor who has really demonstrated what a professor can be. And I have no doubt when you go for your re-rating, it will be higher. I have no doubt about that. So we then, that commitment from yourself then, As I think now you can no longer be saying you are emerging or you are young. No, you've passed that now. So what needs to happen is that you now need to pay back. And this, again, you are, it is showing in your profile that you in the way you are conducting your business in the profession. We are expecting, of course, more students out of you, more publications, and of course, we expect you to be a mentor to others who are upcoming. You are no longer that young, upcoming scholar yourself. You need to be now taking others along and ensuring that we get more professors of your caliber in our space. Now, with us as a university now talking on behalf of your faculty and of course management, we need to create that enabling environment that will ensure that you keep rising higher and higher. And of course, we have said how we intend to do that through our strategic plan. And the key among others is to provide the funding, I'll say seed funding, of course, it's not like full-fledged, and of course a professional of your caliber is now in a position to go out and get others, and you have done that. You have done that. You have really attracted a lot of external funding, and you should keep it up. And also to provide that space for creativity so that we see you rising until you become an A-rated researcher. Yes, it will happen. So in closing then, Professor Chinyamrindi, just going back to your lecture where you, in essence, you were showing us that we need to be mindful of how we balance that human and organizational human and organizational capabilities, and really showing us the six strategies that you captured very well. That is the essence of what we want to see. And also, I got reminded of the Y2K bug that used to haunt some of us just prior to 2000. I think maybe you were still. But the academic prophets of the day had actually painted another picture around how, among others, you know, come the year 2000, things would just turn around. And yeah. And again, I remember I was in the library space at that time, and we were told that going ahead, technology will take over. There will be no books in libraries. All people will need to do will just be to press a button, and everything will be there. And here we are. We are still needing librarians because the human element is still very much critical, even though we are embracing technology, we are utilizing e-resources. Once again, thank you again for being who you are in this university. Please keep it up, and we will continue to support you. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's my very pleasant task to do the vote of thanks. It's really an honor and a privilege to be here today. Professor Chinyamrindi, you really made me reflect with your lecture. It's such a time, yes, your work is so timely and so important for now. And what I really enjoyed as you spoke was that it made me reflect about especially my two granddaughters, who are 2 and 4. And as you spoke, I wondered what work would be by the time they will be of a working age, and whether we'd even have the idea of work. And so as you spoke, I thought, I will be interested to see how your own thinking is going to change and develop over the next 10, 15, 20 years. So thank you for making us think deeply and reflect about this really, really important topic and important work that you're doing. So so my first thank you is to you for all the effort, enormous effort it takes to do the research, to publish, to have students, to develop programs. And I know you're doing all of that, so thank you for your contribution to the university, to the field that you're working in, and I'm looking forward to see that grow and change and develop into the future. Let me also use this opportunity to thank the faculty, where you have been, all the members of the faculty, the people in your department who support you. You refer to them quite a lot, so it's really good to see that you've got a good team around you. And because that's what it takes, right, to do important work. It takes a lot of people around you. I want to thank your family, and it was very evident as you presented that you have a very strong, big supportive network. And I want to thank your family for that support to enable you to do what you do, to be who you are. So a very big thank you to them. And then, of course, to all the people who are here and all the people who are listening online, thank you for making the time to be a part of this inaugural lecture and to participate in this important event in the university. And then, of course, in putting an event like this together requires a number of departments in the university to work together. The Office of the Registrar, who organize everything about the procession and so on. Certainly the faculty and the dean, who make sure that the introductions and the lectures and all of that happen. A very big thank you to our institutional advancement, who do the events, coordinating and planning, and also to ICT. So with that, a very big thank you and a successful lecture, and we are looking forward to many more. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will take the national anthem, and on completion of the national anthem, we'll release the academic procession. Please be upstanding.
Oh, no.